Hi, welcome to today's lecture on meat species identification. So here we will try to understand how to identify or differentiate different kind of meat. Kind means meat from different species. So nowadays there are a lot of mixing or substitution of meat from one species to another. That is a fraudulent practice. We have to understand how to identify such different species of meat. Species identification actually is a more broader aspect. Here, how to test meat and animal byproducts to confirm they come from the animal stated on the label or documentation. So it is applicable to not only meat, it is applicable to other byproducts, and also it is important for food and feed industries. In feed industry, many kind of byproducts are used as supplement. There also can be mixing or substitution or fraudulent practices of different origin of species. So this is pertaining to that also. But today our topic will be limited to about meat and meat products. We were concerned about the substitution or wrong labeling of meat and meat products. You can see there are different origin of meat and meat products. It could be from sheep, goat, or beef, pork, even fish, and different kind of meat products. How to identify them based on their characteristics? In details, we are going to discuss. This change of meat species is also called as adulteration of meat or sometimes substitution, and that's why we are calling it identification of meat species. Adulteration of meat involves substitution of costly or superior quality meat with cheaper, undesirable, or inferior quality of meat. It is a fraudulent practice that is objectionable on grounds of health, religion, and economics. So, what is the meaning of adulteration? When we change one meat with another species and call it that species. This is objectionable and it has got several illegal options. It is a fraudulent practice because we are presenting the meat with a wrong name or characteristic. So sometimes economically it is illegal, sometimes religious point of view it is wrong. The substitutions generally practiced are mutton for chicken. So we may sell the mutton as chicken, beef for kara beef, beef for mutton, rabbit meat for chicken, and sometimes dog or cat meat or veal, that is the meat from calf, as jibon. So there has been recently a lot of report in different cities about dog meat being sold as mutton or jibon in several cities including Chennai, Kolkata, etc. So as per law, it is punishable under Prevention of Food Adulteration Act 1955. So this kind of substitution is punishable under the law. It is possible to identify species when in the form of carcass or joints based on anatomical characteristics. So when a full carcass is wrongly presented, a mutton carcass is presented as jibon, that can be easily identified based on the knowledge of expert knowledge of anatomical characteristics of the bones and the other details. Similarly, if it is available as cuts with full joints, it is possible. But their recognition in minced meat or in product form depends on chemical and biological tests. So when the meat is cut into pieces or minced without bone, and sometime when we make the ready-to-eat meat products, there if the meat is mixed or substituted, it is not easy to differentiate. So there we have to go for very specific chemical characteristics Even better methods are based on biological tests. Before I go for discussing details about the different methods for identification of species of meat, let me give you a brief background of different kind of meats. Here you can see in the left side two carcasses of mutton, that is sheep carcass or lamb sometime we call when it is younger. So the color of the meat will be more darker in red. In the right side, you can see the characteristics in terms of color differences in between species. In case of beef, it is cherry red color, white fat, and larger in size. In case of pork, it is pale pink color and whitish fat. In case of lamb, as I already said, it is darker red color, white fat, and small size. Here again, you can see the color difference between three different meat. The left bottom corner, you can see the turkey meat. It is somewhat whitish color. At the middle diagonally, you can see the beef meat, which is comparatively darker red. Whereas at the top right corner, you can see the pork meat, which is again light red in color. Here you can see the dressed goat carcasses, and the goat meat is called as jivan. If you see the carcass, it is comparatively less dark red and more slim or slender. Whereas in case of mutton or sheep carcass, the color is more dark red and the carcass will be more white type or a barrel type look. So this is the typical difference between sheep and goat carcass. Here we can see the meat from calf, which is called veal, and the meat from young pig or piglets. So if you see the color wise, there is not much difference because both are from young animals. So unless we get it as a whole carcass, it is very difficult to differentiate. The veal is slightly reddish, more reddish in color, whereas the piglet is slightly paler red in color. Otherwise, if it is cut into pieces, it is very difficult to differentiate. Here we can see a dressed carcass of chicken in the left side, another dressed carcass of rabbit. So I told earlier there is a practice of substitution of chicken meat with rabbit because the color of both is almost similar, but sometimes it can be either way depending on the availability and price. Suppose if rabbit meat is available more at a lower price, it can be sold as a chicken. If we cut it into pieces, it is very difficult to identify. So I have given a brief background about different kind of meat and what is the meat identification or adulteration. Now we are going to discuss about common techniques used for meat species identification. So these techniques are physical techniques or physical methods where physical characteristics are used for different meat species identification. Then there is anatomical techniques where the anatomical structure, skeletal, bone, and their specific characteristics are used. Then there is histological techniques. Here the cellular level, the histological minute structures are different between species from which the species can be differentiated or identified. Then there is chemical techniques or chemical methods where the specific chemicals are different. Many specific chemicals are different in different species. So based on that, many tests are available. Then biological techniques, where the either the serological or immunological and sometimes other specific biological properties are used. Then there is physicochemical techniques. Then there is DNA based molecular techniques. So nowadays in the advanced biology, the molecular biology is the most advanced and most authentic. So most of these tests are based on DNA and RNA and more feasible and authentic for identifying different meat species. So similarly, few modern techniques also we are going to discuss. Now we will discuss about the first method, that is physical method. So physical methods means the typical characteristics of each species of meat based on their physical properties. So in this case, mainly we will focus on two aspects. One is the general characteristics of the meat, another is the characteristics of the fat. So here you can see the column, every species is given in the left side. First we will see about the general appearance or general characteristics of meat. So if we see in case of chivon and mutton, which are more similar, the color wise the mutton is more darker red. If we see the consistency of the meat, the goat meat is more strong or firm. If we go by odor, the goat meat will have a goaty odor, whereas in case of mutton it will be ammoniacal smell. Then if we go by fat characteristics, here you will see the goat meat fat is pure white, more white than mutton. If we see the consistency of the fat, in case of mutton or sheep, it is more hard or firm. Similarly, the karabib, that is from the buffalo, and beef, these two are more similar. Here we will see the color is more dark in karabib and the consistency of the meat is more firm in karabib. Whereas in case of fat, the buffalo fat will be pure white, whereas beef fat will be yellowish white. That's a typical difference. Similarly, the firmness of fat, in case of beef, the fat is more firm or hard. Now we will see the pork and chicken. So both are a little bit light, but pork meat is light red, whereas the chicken is almost whitish. Then you will see the characteristics of meat. In case of pork, it is quite soft, whereas in poultry, it is little bit firm. In case of pork, sometime urine-like smell will be there. And the color of fat, if we see in case of chicken, the fat is yellow, whereas in case of pork, it is white color, the fat. And the consistency of the fat, in case of pork, it is soft or greasy. In case of chicken also, it is very soft. So this is the typical characteristic differences in the properties of meat and the fat, based on which we can make some differences when the large cuts of meat are available. Now the second method, that is anatomical method, we will discuss. Here one is the dentition formula, which is sometimes useful. Another is the number of ribs, then number of different vertebra in different species, different type of vertebra varies, and then the typical characteristics of some of the long bones. So if we see the dentition formula, it is cattle and buffalo, it is same, so it is not possible to differentiate. In sheep and goat, it is same again. Only in pig, it is different. So if there is a substitution between pig and sheep and goat, but that will be very rare. Similarly, pig and cattle also rare. Whereas in case of horse and cattle, if there is a substitution with the whole carcass, then it is useful. Otherwise, it is not very useful. Then about the ribs. So number of ribs varies, but in case of cattle, sheep and goat and dog, it is same as 13 number. And among that, the sternal ribs are slightly different. In case of dog, it is only one more, that is 9. If we see the pig, it is 14 to 15 ribs. So if it is a whole carcass with pig and sheep and goat, it is possible. But again, that's a very rare possibility. In case of horse, there are 18 ribs. So horse and cattle, if the whole carcass is substituted, then it is useful. Otherwise, it is not very useful. So these, another specific characteristics of the long bones. In case of long bone, in different species, they have typical characteristics in the both extremities, that is the upper extremity and the lower extremity. Based on that, some species can be identified. Similarly, the number of different type of vertebra varies, like cervical vertebra, thoracic vertebra, lumbar vertebra. These numbers vary. So if we get a whole carcass and if it is misrepresented, based on these anatomical characteristics, we can identify. But altogether, these methods are not very useful, and rarely a whole carcass will be substituted. The third method is histological method, where the muscle fiber diameter, the shape and size of the fiber, and number of muscle fibers are important for identifying the species. The diameter and number of muscle fibers determined by a fiber optic microscope can also lead to species identification. Diameter of muscle fiber of buffalo is more than ox, whereas muscle fiber of buffalo are smaller in size and polygonal in cross section compared to large and irregular muscle fibers of ox. The size of muscle fibers in decreasing order, it is largest in pig, then beef, then buffalo, then sheep, then goat, and finally poultry is the smallest. However, these characteristics are not very useful or very authentic in real dispute of identification of species of meat. Number four, the chemical methods. So here we will see some of the typical chemical properties or characteristics of meat and fat, which is specific or different in different species of meat. So first is fat percentage. That is, the muscular fat content varies according to the species. In case of mutton, that is from sheep, it is about 13.3%, pork 4.4%, chivon 3.6%, beef 2.6%, karabib 0.9%. But these values may vary depending on the feeding practices, so they cannot be very authentic or useful for actual identification of species. Then myoglobin content. In horse flesh, it contains maximum myoglobin up to 0.71%, which is much higher than the muscle of other animals. In case of beef, it could be up to 0.5. In other species, it is still lower than that. So this can be an indicator for muscle test based on the chemical properties. Then glycogen content. In horse flesh, it is richer, up to 1% glycogen. In other food animals, it will be much lower than that. This is another chemical indicator. Then we will see the characteristics or properties of fat. The first one is the refractive index. This is a typical property of fat. So here in case of horse, it is 53.5. Whereas in case of ox, it will be around 40 or below. In case of pig, it will be 50 and below. Then another one is iodine number. This indicates the quality of the fatty acid present in fat. If the unsaturated fatty acids are more, then the iodine number will be more. So the fat is reacted with iodine and then we get this value. In case of horse fat, it is about 70 to 85, which is quite higher. Whereas in case of lard, it is 50 to 70. In case of beef and sheep meat, it is about 35 to 46. Then another one is carotene content. So this is absent in buffalo fat but present in cow fat. We have discussed earlier the buffalo fat will be white in color due to the absence of carotene, whereas cow fat or even cow milk fat will be yellow due to the presence of carotene. Then fatty acid analysis. If we see, there is a typical fatty acid, that is linoleic acid. This is the essential fatty acid, which is quite high in case of horse fat, that is about 1 to 2%, whereas in all other species meat, this fatty acid will be less than 0.1%. So these chemical properties can be sometime useful, but in a real dispute they are not very reliable or authentic to identify the species of meat. Number five is physicochemical methods. Sometime here the both physical and chemical properties together are used for differentiating the species, but more specifically here the electrophoresis is used, so it can be called as electrophoretic methods. So electrophoretic methods have been found to achieve the separation of proteins by their differential migration through a supporting medium under the influence of an electric field. So the protein bands thus resolved are visualized for characteristic pattern by direct observation or densitometric scanning. So here the meat sample is extracted and only the protein is used for separation. And for each species, there is differences in protein and their molecular weight. So all the protein gets separated and it produces a typical band pattern specific for each species. So it becomes a protein profile which can be compared with the typical profile of that species. So they are done by two types. One is by application of an electric current which produces separation on the basis of electrical charge. So the protein molecules will move based on the electric charge it gets. And the another one is based on molecular weight. So this is called molecular sieving. Here the separation is based on pore size of the material through which the components of a mixture migrate. So based on the molecular weight. So there are two approaches for electrophoresis. So each species, they have got typical proteins and they have typical charge or molecular weight. So finally, a protein profile is obtained which is compared with the specific reference profile of the species. So this is useful for specific pure meat. If they are mixed, then this profile will not match with the reference one. In continuation to the previous one, so the physicochemical methods, which is mainly here the electrophoretic methods. So there are different type of electrophoresis, as I said, but here mainly we will discuss about the electrophoresis based on molecular weight. And this is mainly three types we will discuss here. One is polyacrylamide disc electrophoresis. Here the preparation of goat, sheep, cattle and buffalo meat has been used for particular species of fresh meat which are identified according to the band pattern, which I have discussed earlier, based on the typical protein profile which can be compared with the reference for each species, and the meat can be identified. The number two is polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis. Here, after electrophoresis and staining, the band pattern is observed for identification. It is applicable to meat cooked at less than 80 degrees Celsius for 10 minutes. So if the meat is cooked more than that, it will not be suitable because meat will be denatured and it will not be possible to identify. Every time the standard should be run along with the sample. So that standard profile or standard band pattern helps in identifying the bands separated in the process of electrophoresis. So polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis, which is also called as PAGE. The third method is a further improvised method of this page, that is SDS page or sodium dodecyl sulfate polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis. Here proteins move according to their molecular weights. The resultant bands can be observed for species specificity. So this method is highly useful for cooked meat and for meat products. Another method of electrophoresis is isoelectric focusing. This is a further modified method of electrophoresis. It is mainly based on the migration of proteins in a pH gradient. The process stops when the surface charges become neutral at isoelectric point. The subsequent fixing makes the protein precipitated and fixed at the same point as a band. It is a suitable method for identification of animal species even after cooking at 100 degrees Celsius. However, it is not very suitable for meat from closely related species. So in this method, a medium is prepared with a gradient of pH with a very minimum differences. Now the meat sample is put for electrophoresis and the protein will separate based on the isoelectric pH. So every protein has got a specific isoelectric pH. When it reaches to that pH, it will stop and it makes a band. So finally, all the proteins will move to different place and get fixed, and we get a final profile of protein which will be compared with the reference and species can be identified. Now we will discuss about more modern method based on biological properties, and one of them is called as immunological methods, or sometime we can call serological methods. These tests are based on the principle that a reaction between soluble antigen and its corresponding specific antibody yields a visible precipitate at the point of their reaction. So in this case, the meat sample is triturated and the extract is used as an antigen, and the antibody is already prepared from these proteins from the lab animals. Now the reaction between this sample antigen and the already developed antibody gives the test. So one of the first common simple test based on this is called precipitation test or ring test. It is also known as ring precipitation test, in which antigen and antibodies reacts to make a ring at the point of mixing. If precipitation line forms, then it indicates a positive test. That means if the meat sample we got, it is having a specific antigen of that particular species, and we have used already the antibody from that species. So if they are same, then there will be a positive test which gives a ring. It gives false positive test in closely related species due to cross reactivity. As I told earlier, the closely related species like cattle and buffalo, they have many proteins which are similar. So in that case, it may give a false positive. Similarly, in case of sheep and goat, they have similar many proteins and give cross reactivity. So this test, that is the disadvantage. So this is another method or based on immunology, which is called Agar-Gel immunodiffusion test, or sometime AGID. This is also known as complement fixation test, commonly used in diagnostic purpose in bacteriology. So here the principle is same as precipitation test, but a complement is used to reproduce the results for longer duration. Here the guinea pig serum as complement and sheep RBC and rabbit serum is used as indicator. This test can be used for both qualitative and quantitative test. Adulteration up to 5% and meat cooked at 80 degrees Celsius for less than 10 minutes can be detected. So in this case, if you see in the diagram, at the center, the unknown sample will be extracted, and that sample will be used as antigen and kept at the center. And all around, the typical antisera, which is already raised from different species, will be used for test. Now, if this antigen, that is the sample meat extract, if it has got the different species, then it will give the positive reaction with the antisera from different other species. And that is how we can identify whether there is an adulteration or not. Here is the third immunological test, which is called double immunodiffusion test. This test is extensively used for detection of meat species. It is performed in well punched on agarose gel, buffalo anti-cattle serum and rabbit anti-cattle serum found to be most suitable. It is easy and cheap test for identifying raw or heated meat at 80 degrees Celsius. It is time consuming and ineffective for thoroughly cooked meat. It can detect adulteration up to 5%. So you can see in the round diagram right side, here two different antigens are used, A and B, and the other side two different antiserum is used. So when both the antigen and both the antiserum is same, then it gives double positive indication. So this test, the highly cooked meat, when it is beyond 80 degrees Celsius, the proteins get denatured and it will lose the antigenic property. So it will not be useful for this immunological test. Here is the fourth immunological method, which is further modified to make it more efficient and fast. This is called counter immunoelectrophoresis or CIE. So CIE is an immunodiffusion test in which electric voltage is used for acceleration of protein movement. In this technique, alkaline gel is used, which causes electroosmosis. Here, homologous antibodies and proteins move towards each other and forms a precipitation band. It is a rapid and more sensitive, can detect one part of species in 300 part of meat. That means about 0.35%. If the adulteration is less than even 1%, it can detect. So this is a combination of both immunological and electrophoretic method. And under the influence of electrophoresis, the antigen-antibody reaction happens and the movement of proteins are very fast and it makes a band which is identified in a very short time. Here is the last immunological method, that is enzyme-linked immunosorbent assay, or commonly called as ELISA. You must have read about it in biochemistry and microbiology. Commonly, this test is used for diagnosis of many bacterial diseases. Here, antigen-antibody reaction occurs in a monomolecular layer, immobilized on an inert surface, and followed by means of an enzyme chemically bonded to one of the immunoreagents, that is either antigen or antibody. Two versions of tests are used here. One is solid phase indirect ELISA, another is capture ELISA. In capture ELISA assay, it employs an antibody adsorbed to the PVC wells, PVC is polyvinyl chloride, to bind meat antigen and enzyme leveled species specific antibody to detect the presence of bound antigen. This is a rapid test and the results are obtained in 2 to 3 hours. The test is very sensitive and can detect even 2% adulteration. So here you can see the sample preparation from pork meat. It is extracted and purified after centrifugation. Extract sample is used and added with the antibody. After that, it is added with the enzyme, added another anti-pig antibody, and then there is a reaction from this enzyme. We can assess how much of the antigen is used in the antigen-antibody reaction, and the final result is detected in an ELISA reader. So this is a very sensitive method for identification of meat adulteration. Earlier we have discussed protein-based methods like electrophoresis, different kind, and different type of immunological methods. Now we will see little more modern methods, that is molecular biology methods. DNA-based molecular techniques. Analysis of DNA rather than protein is more useful for species identification due to its stability at high temperature. So DNA is more stable at high temperature, so it is more advantageous to use it for species identification. The mitochondrial DNA is more conserved in different species of animals. So in different species, mitochondrial DNA is more specific, so it is more useful for species identification. Cytochrome B gene is most commonly targeted for meat identification. Mitochondrial 12S rRNA gene with higher precision. So mitochondrial 12 rRS gene is more commonly used as a more specific for different species. So here we will discuss different methods on this principle, where the DNA is isolated and purified, and then it is amplified and detected for matching with different species specific DNA. We will discuss different methods next. DNA hybridization techniques. This is one of the earliest method developed based on DNA for species identification. Here the DNA is amplified or hybridized for identification of particular species. It is a qualitative or semi-quantitative technique in which species-specific DNA sequence is detected. This method does not require the development of species-specific probes. It is most suitable for critical samples in which DNA is largely degraded. This is a good technique for detection of adulteration as low as 0.1%. but it cannot quantify, only it can say the presence or absence of a particular species of meat. Now we are going to discuss a very popular modern method called PCR, that is polymerase chain reaction. You have studied in biochemistry and microbiology and other subjects. So PCR is a rapid method. We can obtain copies of specific piece of DNA sequence in vitro, and it has high specificity and sensitivity. PCR amplifies a target DNA sequence capable of detecting even a single copy from a single cell sample. It is a qualitative test for meat species, so we cannot identify or quantify the amount of meat mixed with other meat. It can detect closely related meat species, and male and female raw meat can also be identified. So here, when we get the meat sample, we have to take and extract the DNA, and that DNA will be amplified in the process, and that will be detected later about the matching of different species. So this PCR is applied by different techniques, which we are going to discuss next. So here is one of the PCR method, that is random amplified polymorphic DNA fingerprinting, or in short it is called RAPD, RAPD. Here modified PCR DNA fingerprints are generated in very short time, visualized on gel electrophoresis. Prior knowledge of DNA sequence not required, but known standard has to be run each time. DNA extracted from sample amplified with specific primers. So here we need the primer, and with the help of that only DNA is amplified. DNA fragments are visualized by UV transillumination. So this is one of the earlier method of PCR in which the DNA is amplified, then it is run through gel electrophoresis. Here we need the probe, and through which only DNA is amplified, and later on it is visualized with the help of UV transillumination, and detection is done. The second PCR based method is PCR RFLP, that is PCR restricted fragment length polymorphism. Here it is modified PCR target gene is amplified, and resultant PCR product is digested with specific restriction endonuclease enzyme to get a restriction pattern fingerprints. Here the first step is extraction of DNA polymerase and specific primers. Suitable for very low amount of meat, even up to 1 milligram. It is suitable for identification of even degraded DNA. It is faster and more sensitive than DNA hybridization. Identification of male and females by using genomic DNA from meat is also possible. Not 100% accurate due to some intra-species variability, particularly between sheep, turkey, and chicken meat. The next PCR method is species-specific PCR. So this technique is very, very sensitive and accurate for identifying a very particular species of meat origin. In this technique, species-specific DNA can be detected in both raw and processed meat samples by targeted amplification of rDNA genes. It can be 12, 16 or 18S, or it can be actin multigene, or myofibrillar components, or cytochrome B gene. All these things also can be used for DNA extraction and amplification. Old samples, even more than 100 million years old, can also be identified. So this is another variety of PCR technique where a particular species DNA is amplified and detected, and very accurately. Here is another variety of PCR which is very, very useful for meat species identification, that is multiplex PCR. That means several species origin of meat can be simultaneously detected. In this technique, many targets are simultaneously amplified, which helps in detection of many species in a short period of time. Organ meat can also be detected, like mixing of duck liver in goose liver. Common forward and several species-specific reverse primers to nuclear repeated target, that is 5S rDNA gene, is used. So in this case, sometime we may get meat sample which is mixed with several species. So that time this technique is very useful. So suppose cattle, sheep, goat, pig, all the species are mixed together. So if we use this method, all the species can be simultaneously detected through this technique. Now we will discuss some recent and modern methods. One of them is forensically informative nucleotide sequencing, or in short, FINS, F-I-N-S. So here the nucleotide, that is DNA sequencing, is done. Forensically informative nucleotide sequencing, a technique that combines DNA sequencing and phylogenetic analysis. It is used to identify samples based on informative nucleotide sequences. PCR amplification and sequencing of conserved gene is one of the first techniques for meat species identification. Mitochondrial DNA is highly conserved. Gene on it, that is cytochrome B and 12S rRNA, used for meat species identification. So this is one of the most modern method in which PCR amplification is done and a conserved gene sequencing is also done. So this is very, very useful, and it is also used for wildlife species identification also. Here is another modern method, that is real-time PCR, or sometimes commonly called as RT-PCR. In this method, PCR products are monitored and detected during amplification in the same reaction vessel with the help of fluorescent compounds. The technique identifies the product during its amplification. In this technique, quantification of the meat species is also possible. So here the polymerization takes place with the help of reporter and quencher, and once the polymerization is over, it produces the cleavage product, and that product is identified with the help of cleavage. So here the progress of amplification through the process of PCR is monitored simultaneously during the process itself. Here is another modern method which can be applied for meat species identification. In short, it is called LAMP. The actual name is loop-mediated isothermal amplification of DNA. So this technique has got a lot of advantages. Here from the meat sample, DNA is extracted. Then it is mixed with the reagent, that is the LAMP reagent. And then it is incubated in a water bath at a constant temperature. And in 30 to 60 minutes, the reaction will be over. And after that, it will be tested with the help of an appropriate gel ladder-like pattern. So the advantage of this method is that it no need of costly instruments. Like in case of PCR, there is a thermocycler which is costly, is not required. We can use a simply water bath, and it works in constant temperature. It is very fast and it prevents any contamination, and there is no need of post amplification any process. So this method is also being tried for meat species identification. Now we are at the end of this lecture, so I will briefly summarize different aspects of different techniques I have discussed. So firstly, no single test is good enough to differentiate all types of meat. Physical, chemical, and anatomical methods are more suitable for raw meat, particularly if the whole carcass or a big cut is available, then only it is useful. But most of the time, that is not the major cases. Comminuted meat products require sophisticated techniques like DID, SDS page, isolectic focusing, ELISA, and RIA, that is radio immunoassay. This we have not discussed. This is the radio labeled antibody is used for detection of meat. Then DID method cannot distinguish between closely related species, that is between sheep and goat or between cattle and buffalo. ELISA and SDS page is hampered by the cumbersome process of isolating species specific serum. So that's a cumbersome process. Then RAPD generates specific DNA fingerprint pattern for differentiation of red meats in a short time. That's the advantage of RAPD, but it is not so commonly developed nowadays. Then multiplex PCR, RT-PCR, LAMP. These are the most modern method and very sensitive method for meat species detection. This is the last part. I want to keep some more extra information, like meat species identification laboratory. So in India, we have a NABL accredited laboratory in National Research Center on Meat in Hyderabad. They are commercially taking the sample and giving the result very promptly and very authentic. This is a ICAR institute. Similarly, there is another famous institute in Hyderabad that is initially came under CCMB, that is Center for Cellular and Molecular Biology. They have started first the DNA based identification of species, mainly for the wildlife conservation. Later from that, a new institute is created, that is CDFD, or Center for DNA Fingerprinting and Diagnostics. So this does all wide range of species identification by most modern methods. And finally, there is a book which I have told last time, that is Meat Quality Analysis. Here there is two exhaustive chapters on this, details about the meat species identification, written by two eminent scientists, are mostly from ICAR and NRC Meat. So altogether, this is briefly about the different methods and approaches for identification of meat species. Actually, it's a very, very vast topic. I have tried to put everything in a very precisely, and please try to read from other sources. Thank you.